Dear colleagues, good morning. And first of all, I want to thank the organizer for the kind invitation and for discussing one topic that is really relevant in the management of patients with non-small cell lung cancer, that is the treatment of the options that we have for a brain metastasis, particularly in the group of patients that are candidate for target therapies. When we look at the overall population of patients with non-small cell lung cancer, the general incidence of brain metastasis is approximately 20-30%. But this percentage increase when we look at the patient with EGFR mutations, we have an incidence that is up to 40%, and up to 50% in the group of patients with ALK rearrangement. Of course, we can ask what are the reasons, if I can have the slides over there, why we have this difference in terms of incidence. Well, probably the reason is a different tumor biology. And also we have to consider that fortunately today with the ALK inhibitors, with the EGFR inhibitors, we are extending survival of patients. So these patients survive longer, and therefore we can they can develop much more easy during the time of their disease, brain metastasis. In addition, many of the agents we are using today for treating patients with EGFR mutations or ALK rearrangement has some limitation in penetrating blood-brain barrier. These are all the reasons why today we can observe this higher incidence of brain metastasis in patients with EGFR mutations or in patients with ALK rearrangement. What is also extremely important to consider when we treat a patient with EGFR mutation or with ALK rearrangement are the how long the patient can survive during the treatment. This is extremely important, and that is the reason why I'm putting here these slides. Here you can see on the left side, you can see what is the outcome of patients with non-small cell lung cancer, so a general population of non-small cell lung cancer with brain metastasis. Well, the median overall survival classically is around 7 months. So classically, if we have a patient with a brain metastasis, median survival is 7 months. But when we look to a patient with a driver, and here I'm showing you the data with patients with ALK with ALK rearrangement, you can see that even in presence of brain metastasis, the survival, the median survival of this patient is between 4 and 5 years. So this patient survived for a very long time. This is extremely important for our daily clinical practice, particularly when we discuss with our radiation oncologist what is the radiotherapy we need to offer to this patient. Because many radiation oncologists prefer to deliver whole brain radiotherapy. But we have to consider that because the survival of this patient is very long, we need also to take care about the possibility of inducing cognitive impairment in the patients. Therefore, the message that we have is that, first of all, brain metastasis, particularly in patients with ALK rearrangement, is not a negative prognostic factor. Second, we need to give a preference for a local therapy, so for a stereotactic radiotherapy instead of whole brain radiotherapy. To patients with EGFR mutations, today we have different drugs potentially available. During the first session, we had some discussion about which agent we should prefer. We have three agents approved: erlotinib, gefitinib, afatinib. These three agents are absolutely equal in terms of efficacy. We have only some small difference in terms of the toxicity profile. What is extremely interesting is that all of these three agents, so afatinib, erlotinib, and gefitinib, penetrate very low across the blood-brain barrier. So these agents are not really effective against brain metastasis. We had last year at ASCO presented some data on a new compound from AstraZeneca, AZD3759, with a very robust possibility to cross the blood-brain barrier. This agent seems very, very promising, very effective, and in fact, during the ASCO this year, were presented some data in a phase one trial showing an impressive ability of this drug to induce a regression of a tumor in the brain. So this is this agent is still a first generation EGFR TKI, but is different than other agents because it's able to penetrate blood-brain barrier. Therefore, this is probably an agent that will be extremely useful for our clinical practice, if of course this agent will be approved. In patients progressing to EGFR TKIs, and specifically to patients with a secondary mutation in the EGFR gene, the T790M mutation, osimertinib today from AstraZeneca, Tagrisso, this is the commercial name of the drug, is probably the most exciting drug that we have. And again, this agent is able to penetrate the blood-brain barrier. We have clearly preclinical models indicating that the drug penetrates very well the blood-brain barrier, much better than other agents. And also, in some animal models, we have the evidence of a very good penetration on the brain. We don't have only preclinical data or data in animal models. We also have clinical data that were presented this year during the ASCO meeting. I want to show you the data from this trial, the BLOOM trial, two cohorts of patients, one that was treated with AZD3759, we already discussed about this agent, and the other cohort of patients was treated with osimertinib. These were patients with leptomeningeal disease or brain metastasis, so patients with a very aggressive disease, with a very difficult to treat disease. And in this study, patients receiving osimertinib had a very good response. Among the 21 patients that were evaluated, 7 patients had a confirmed partial response, also with a very, very important duration of response. So this is a very effective agent. And the data we have with osimertinib today are inducing us to believe that these agents could become, in the next future, our first-line standard therapy in patients with metastatic EGFR mutant non-small cell lung cancer. For patients with ALK rearrangement, we have, at the present time, we have in Europe only one drug that is approved, also in a first-line setting. This drug is crizotinib. Crizotinib was at the beginning approved in second-line setting based on the result of this trial, the profile 1007. The quality of the images is very bad because you are showing here just half of the slide, so if you can correct in some way. So in the profile 1007, the crizotinib was compared to chemotherapy, pemetrexed or docetaxel, and the trial was positive for crizotinib. Importantly, you can see here the benefit produced by crizotinib was present even in the group of patients with brain metastasis. And we had also similar results in the profile 1014, so a phase 3 trial comparing crizotinib versus chemotherapy in frontline setting. Again, in this trial, there is, people cannot see the title, so it's difficult also to follow what I'm saying. If you can, again, correct the quality of here, the images, it's not, the images here are not, I don't know if somebody can ask the technician to make this kind of correction. So you can see here that the intracranial time to progression was superior with crizotinib when compared to chemotherapy, with also a disease control rate on the brain at 12 and finally we have a good images. with a disease control rate in the brain that was at 12 and 24 weeks, significantly in favor of patients receiving crizotinib. So this data clearly indicates that crizotinib has some activity in presence of brain metastasis in clinical trials, so in prospective trials, but also in some retrospective data. I want to show you here some data that were published last year in the Journal of Clinical Oncology. So that was a pooled analysis of patients participating in some trials with crizotinib, specifically the profile 1005 and 1007. And among patients participating in the study, you can see here that in patients with previously untreated brain metastasis, the median progression-free survival was superior in the systemic lesion compared to the intracranial lesion. This is an extremely important message again for our practice, because what is the consequence for our practice, for our daily clinical practice? The consequence is that if we have in our practice a patient with brain metastasis, ALK rearranged, and our option is crizotinib, is better to offer radiotherapy, radiation therapy to this patient before starting crizotinib. So it's better to give crizotinib in patients with brain metastasis that were already irradiated. So radiation therapy should precede the usage of the drug. Another important concept we have with target therapies, and of course here I'm showing you some data again with crizotinib, is what we call the treatment behind progression. Meaning that we can, in some cases, when the disease is under control and we have particularly just one site that is progressing, for example, brain metastasis, we can continue the treatment with the therapy. And by using this approach, we have evidence that we have a positive impact on the duration of life of the patient. These are some data published in Annals of Oncology a couple of years ago. We also have a pooled analysis of trials, profile 1001 and 1005 with crizotinib, showing that patients in which crizotinib was continued behind progression had a positive impact on survival. And this is true in general, but also is true for the patients with intracranial progression. Because when we look specifically to patients progressing on the brain, even in this patient, the continuation of crizotinib translated in a benefit that was produced for the patients. So all of this data indicates, again, the potential efficacy of crizotinib, even in the group of patients with brain metastasis. And when we offer this drug, I repeat, it's better that the patient were already irradiated. And when we have to choose the radiation therapy, it's better that we prefer something more conservative for the patient, for example, stereotactic radiotherapy instead of whole brain radiotherapy, because of the problem that I presented at the beginning of the cognitive impairment for the patients. When we look to the new inhibitors, new ALK inhibitors, in general, we have evidence that these drugs seems more effective against brain metastasis. All of these agents, alectinib, seritinib, lorlatinib, or brigatinib, are able to cross the blood-brain barrier and are very potent against brain metastasis, with a response rate up to 70-75%. So this agent seems more effective than crizotinib in the group of patients specifically with brain metastasis. And I want to show you some data. I'm showing you here some data with alectinib that were already presented. I'm not presenting now the data with alectinib presented at ASCO, because today I have three lectures. So in my third lecture, I'll present you also the data with alectinib presented at ASCO this year. So in when we look at this data already published in 2015 and 2016, alectinib produced a response rate up to 70% in patients with brain metastasis. So very, very impressive activity. Also, impressive activity seems present with another drug, another ALK inhibitor, that is brigatinib. Brigatinib is very, very interesting drug because brigatinib seems effective. You see here the green cell. It seems effective against all the secondary mutations that we can detect in a patient's progressing after crizotinib. So it seems a very, very interesting drug. And we have some data presented at ASCO this year from this trial, the ALTA trial, that was a phase two trial using two different doses of brigatinib, 90 and 180 milligrams. And when we look specifically to the efficacy, the intracranial efficacy, you can see here again a response rate up to 70%, particularly in the group of patients with a higher dose. So it seems that brigatinib is very effective against brain metastasis, and the dose that probably is more effective is the dose of 180 milligrams, that in fact has been the dose that was chosen by the company for additional for further trials. Another very exciting drug from Pfizer is lorlatinib. Lorlatinib is a potent ALK inhibitor, but also a potent ROS inhibitor. I show you this slide that was presented by Ben Salomon at ASCO this year with this really impressive activity in patients with brain metastasis. So again, this is a very, very promising agent with a very good ability to cross the blood-brain barrier. And the preliminary data we have indicates that the drug could become one of the standard option in patients with ALK positive non-small cell lung cancer. So in conclusion, we can say certainly that brain metastases are more frequent in patients with EGFR mutations and ALK rearrangement. We need to consider that in these patients, the presence of brain metastasis is not a negative prognostic factor. These patients survive for a long time, and therefore we need to consider that, particularly when we present the case for a radiation oncology, to a radiation oncology. And we have new and very exciting drugs currently under development that are demonstrating very, very impressive efficacy in patients with brain metastasis. And I think that these agents will be in current use in the next years. Thank you.
Коллеги, есть ли вопросы?
Are there any questions?
Much for your presentation. I have a question about radiation, brain radiation in patients with EGFR or ALK mutations in the necrosoma patients. What's your opinion? Can we start only EGFR or anti-ALK therapy in this group patients with asymptomatic brain metastasis? We have good results with survival in these patients, but radiation is have risks with cognitive destructions. And what's your opinion in this group patients?
Well, when we discuss about brain patients with brain metastasis, the situation on the clinical point of view is really, really complex because we have different potential situation in clinical practice. In general, if we have a patient with symptomatic, of course, this patient should receive radiotherapy, radiation therapy before starting any treatment. If the patient is asymptomatic, is assuming that today we have drugs available with not an optimal penetration across the blood-brain barrier. So this is the hypothesis in which I'm starting. So I'm not considering now drugs such as osimertinib or alectinib. I'm just considering the drugs that we have today. So in this case, if we can deliver a stereotactic radiotherapy, I prefer deliver stereotactic radiotherapy, and then, or even during the treatment, I give the target inhibition. If we have multiple metastases, This is, of course, a complex situation, but in general, when we have multiple metastases and there is the risk that the patient could become symptomatic, I think it's logical to this patient to offer radiation therapy before starting the treatment. Then the question is, of course, how to integrate radiation therapy and target therapy. This is the usual question I have during meetings. The problem is only with whole brain radiotherapy, because with stereotactic radiotherapy is very rapid treatment. So even if you stop for a couple of days, this is not a problem. I generally prefer not stopping the treatment when we have a long period. That's also why I don't like very much offering whole brain radiotherapy. I really hope that the new drugs will solve this problem, because if we have a drug with a very good penetration on the brain, probably we can give these agents without considering whole brain radiotherapy.
Thank you very much.
My question does not concern directly brain metastasis, but we know that brigantinib, a new LK inhibitor, also have the activity against EGFR-positive tumors. But do you think that this particular drug, or probably you know of any case reports, will be more efficacious in patients with concomitant EGFR and ALK rearrangements?
I don't believe in patients with double mutations. I think that these patients are really rare, represent a very, very, very extremely rare situation. All the time that I found a patient with a double mutation, I asked the lab to repeat the biomarkers, because I think that this situation is really, really uncommon. And for specifically for the question around brigatinib, that's true. The drug at the beginning was developed also as an anti-EGFR agent, but the efficacy against the EGFR mutation is really limited. So I don't think that this is the real, this is a really, on the clinical point of view, an important issue.
Federica, thank you for your beautiful presentation. I have a question about the population which consists of 70% that have no mutations or no any target. Can you say us, what is your opinion about this population? What to do with these patients who have no any targets, no any mutations? What to do?
So I'm sorry, but I didn't understand your question. So what is my option in patients without any mutation?
Yes, what to do with the patients who have no target mutations?
So patients with brain metastasis or without brain metastasis?
Yes, with brain metastasis.
Well, unfortunately for these patients, chemotherapy remains the only option we can offer to the patient. Generally, in patients with asymptomatic brain metastasis, we start with chemotherapy and we give radiation therapy at the end of chemotherapy. This is what we do in our practice. I don't know if this picture could change in some way, because probably you know that the recent press release that we had last Friday from Merck's reporting that pembrolizumab showed superiority in terms of progression-free survival and overall survival versus platinum-based chemotherapy in frontline setting in patients PD-L1 positive. It is extremely important to understand from this trial, we have only the press release, we don't have the data. If also patients with brain metastasis were included, and what was also the control on brain metastasis that we had with this approach.
Thank you.
Bevacizumab in patients with brain metastasis and without EGFR or ALK mutation. Bevacizumab plus chemotherapy in adenocarcinoma patients. Safety and what's your opinion?
Well, I'm not preferring the usage of bevacizumab because a patient has brain metastasis. I use bevacizumab because I consider bevacizumab as an important option that we have together with chemotherapy in frontline setting or even together with erlotinib in patients with EGFR mutations. But my choice is not based on presence of brain metastasis. Even if I consider bevacizumab a very potent anti-edema agent on the brain, so is something that we can also consider when we have a patient in our practice.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Спасибо, коллеги.
Thank you, colleagues. In conclusion, I would like to tell some words concerning the very interesting report and development of target therapy is now moving towards overcoming the resistant mechanisms and new target organs or agents, and increasing the bioavailability across hematoencephalic barrier. I think these perspectives will be brought to reality, but it is in future, but we are living now, today, and would like to stress some things in reality, because the number of patients with brain metastasis is increasing. It is mainly due to increasing lifespan of these patients, even with brain metastasis, and we should understand it quite clearly. And the key issue in this is if the patient has this activating mutation or it is absent. And so we must discern between these two groups, because the patients without mutations, for which may be targeted with drugs, the life of other patients, then their perspective is quite sad. If we know the mutational status of this patient, we must understand or resolve an issue concerning the if these metastases are symptomatic or not, since the presence of metastasis means some deficiency of hematoencephalic barrier, and in these cases the bioavailability comes to the background. And if we are performing the target therapy, and when we evaluate response 2-3 months later, in this case we of course recommend radiation treatment, and our colleague has shown very impressively this strategy of treatment, taking into account the patients, especially with ALK positive. These patients are living more long. And in case, or even in cases of symptomatic brain metastasis, we may switch our attention in this case to controlling of local metastasis using local therapy. And now we are more commonly encountering the effects of targeted therapy, and this is followed by increased percentage of brain metastasis, because the patients live more long, and this progression is connected with generalization of the tumor process. Maybe targeted therapy may be continued in some cases, because this target therapy is anyway useful in cases of mutation positive patients, and we must continue target therapy along with paralleled by radiation therapy by means of gamma knife or total radiation treatment. And one remark more concerning the target drugs which are now registered in Russian Federation. In case of brain metastasis, unfortunately, evaluation was performed not in an isolated manner, as if there was no special effects upon brain metastasis were registered. A general effect was evaluated at time, and the free progression free time was registered only. And the studies, the future studies will show us or delineate a cohort of patients which will gain from target therapy. I have one remark more. There is a multidisciplinary meeting now, and we must consider local methods of local pathology, that surgery and stereotactic surgery could be also considered, and these patients should be discussed in multidisciplinary workshops or meetings.